Okay, welcome. This is Iodine and Histamine, what you and your doctor may not know. This lecture has been divided into two sections. Section one is a review of Dr. Brownstein's book, Iodine, Why You Need It, Why You Can't Live Without It, the fifth edition. And section two is the connection between iodine and histamine. And I like to think of that as the meat and potatoes part of the lecture, which is quite short relative to section one. The reason why I chose to simply review Dr. Brownstein's book for section one is he's the world's clinical leader in iodine, and a lot of the information out there that is being shared really comes from him, so I always believe in giving credit where credit is due, and that's always the best choice. And this is the first of many lectures for the naturedoctor.ca, which is a site that offers lots of free health tips and advice and videos and whatnot, so check it out and share, and I hope you enjoy. Okay. Let's get started. First note on gratitude. I would like to express my gratitude to Dr. David Brownstein for sharing his wisdom on iodine, to which he has over 20 years of clinical experience. And I would like to also express my gratitude to Dr. Gary Schaefer, naturopathic doctor, my mentor, who has shared with me his wisdom on histamine and introduced me to the work of Dr. Brownstein. Gary has over 30 years of clinical experience. All information in Section 1 is taken from Dr. Brownstein's book, Iodine, Why You Need It, Why You Can't Live Without It, the 5th edition. The info on each slide is referenced in the bottom right corner of the frame. Let me move this so we can actually see it. There we go. Where was I? The info on each slide is referenced in the bottom right corner to the corresponding page numbers in his book. Use these numbers to find article references for the information discussed. Note, 70 slides does not replace a 300-page book, but I certainly hope it prompts you to read it. My aim is not only to educate the public, but to inspire and inform healthcare practitioners to learn and advance their practice to achieve a higher degree of patient outcome success. This information is not taught in medical schools and is of the utmost importance. I receive no compensation for this promotion of his work, nor have I been asked to create it. This presentation is simply an act of service. Section 2 is comprised on information on histamine as taught to me by my mentor, Dr. Gary Schaefer, naturopathic doctor, a wise man who I owe a debt of gratitude. And section one, just an overview here. We have iodine deficiency use in history, thyroid disorders, fibrocystic breasts and cancer, environmental toxicity, and summary of concerns. All right, iodine, why we need it. Iodine is necessary for thyroid hormone production. The thyroid contains the highest concentration, but it's also found in all of the cells of the body, and if it's in all of the cells of the body, then it has a purpose. Every gland concentrates iodine and uses iodine to create hormones. It's necessary for proper immune function, and white blood cells can't fight infection without iodine. Iodine is stored in the salivary glands, the cerebral spinal fluid, the brain, particularly the substantia nigra, which is found, which was the area of interest in Parkinson's disease and therefore could be a link also to iodine deficiency. It's in gastric mucosa. It's in the choroid plexus, which produces cerebral spinal fluid. It's in the breast, the ovaries, the ciliary bodies of the eye, the prostate, skin, intestines, red blood cells, and white blood cells. The therapeutic actions of iodine are antibacterial, anti-cancer, anti-parasitic, antiviral. It alkalizes, so it elevates the pH, and it's a mucolytic agent. Lytic means to break down. Muco is for mucus, so it breaks down or thins the mucus. All right. In an iodine deficiency, the top two things people usually think about are cretinism and goiter. Cretinism is just a very severe impairment in physical and mental status. You're born with it. And so the goiter is the big lump in the throat some of us may have seen or have. And now the rest on this list is deafness, infertility, delayed physical and mental abilities, mental impairment, reduced intellectual ability, ADHD, that could also just be autism spectrum disorder, SIDS, sudden infant death syndrome, multiple sclerosis, myelin disorders, cancer, particularly cancers of the breast, prostate, endometrial, and ovarian cancers, and we'll get into the reasons why those cancers. And iodine deficiency is the most preventable worldwide cause of mental retardation, according to the World Health Organization. And a quick little note here at the bottom says iodine excess. That is very rare. You're looking at over a gram of iodine per day, and you'd be looking at experiencing hyperthyroid symptoms. Here's a list of conditions treated by iodine. Feel free to pause now if you want to read them. I'm going to continue moving forward. All right, iodine sources. So if crops are grown in soil with adequate levels, then we are receiving adequate iodine. However, this is very rare. First of all, our soil is generally depleted. And the soil that contains iodine is soil that's closest to the sea. There's a process involving ultraviolet light, how it leaves the sea and gets into the soil. For the simplest way, we'll just say it evaporates. It's not really the accurate way of saying it, but settles on the soil that's closest to the sea. But at this day and age, we might even live near the sea and we're not even consuming foods from that area. We buy our food from all corners of the country and continent and globe. So who knows what it's sufficient in. Iodine is in ocean water, so it's in ocean fish and it's in seaweed. It's in meat, that is, if it was supplemented in the animal's diet. I grew up in the prairies, so I was running around in cattle fields, and I always remember the big blue blocks that are in the middle of the field, and the cows would come and they would lick them. They're called salt licks, and they were just full of minerals, including iodine, and that's how they'd get their fill. Now, people tend to think, well, iodine is in table salt, so aren't I getting enough? Well, this will be a repeated point throughout this lecture, is that iodine, the recommended daily allowance of iodine is set to prevent goiter and cretinism. It's not set at a level to optimize whole body system functioning. And on top of that, table salt is toxic. It's lifeless. All the minerals are removed. And Mother Nature doesn't make salt simply as sodium chloride. It's a whole wide array of minerals and trace elements, and that's what our ancestors have always lived on. We use toxic chemicals to break it down, and we also sell, well, the salt industry sells the remaining minerals to other areas of industry. And we use toxic chemicals to make the salt white. And I don't know what the Western world's, or why the Western world has a fixation on whiteism. I'm glad I don't know, and I'll never understand it. And who had the idea that white simply meant it appeared to be more delicious? I don't understand it. And the fact that we use toxic chemicals that harm our body to do this process is mind baffling. And, you know, thank the Einstein that came up with that one. Also, another note with salt is there are a lot of anti-caking agents added to salt. So aluminum, cyanide, which is disguised as yellow peruziate of soda, ammonium, dextrose, which is sugar. You know, these things get added and we don't need them. I don't want them. We shouldn't be consuming them. All right, so enough on that for the moment. Now, radioactive iodine, that's a source. It's a harmful source. It enters the air from nuclear power plants or explosions of nuclear materials like Fukushima and Chernobyl. And it's toxic, obviously, but non-radioactive iodine is protective against it. And so we probably would have seen a lot more problems, health problems in Japan, had they not been the world's leader in iodine consumption based on the amount of fish and ocean fish and seaweed they consume. Okay, so iodized salt. Getting into the history of iodized salt. So early in the 1900s, we had a high goiter prevalence in America. And interestingly enough, there was a 600% goiter incidence in girls versus boys. So girls were getting a lot more goiters than boys. And the reason being is that women require more iodine than men because of the fact that ovaries are the, after the thyroid, the second highest concentrator of iodine, but also breast tissue concentrates iodine. And so in adolescent girls, they're developing breast tissue. They require more iodine. And Dr. Marine did a study in 1923 in Michigan and Ohio, and he chose those states because they were goiter belt states. Those are the states that border the Great Lakes, and they're called the goiter belt because there's a high prevalence of goiter there due to low soil concentration of iodine. And so he took two groups, one group of 2,300 students and another of 2,200, and he supplemented one of them with 9 milligrams a day of iodine for 2.5 years. And after the 2.5 years, he found that those who received supplementation had a 0.2% goiter incidence, while those who did not receive supplementation had a 22% incidence of goiter. So after that, it was confirmed that iodine deficiency leads to goiter, and iodine was then added to table salt at 100 parts per million as potassium iodide, which is about 77 micrograms of iodine per gram of salt. And we have an iodine deficiency. So why is that? Well, it's estimated that less than 50% of Americans actually use iodized salt. And if you're eating restaurant food or processed food, those foods are high in salt, but that salt most often happens to be non-iodized salt. And then we have an epidemic of hypertension or high blood pressure, and we have a lot of people now who are consuming low salt diets. So even if they are consuming iodized salt, they're not consuming much of it. The National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey studies between 1970 and 2012 found that iodine levels dropped by 50% in the U.S. in the past 40 years, which is pretty significant. And the average salt intake is about 5 grams a day, which is about 385 micrograms of iodine per day. So that's interesting because that number should be fairly significant. That's more than our RDA, which is 150 micrograms a day for iodine. So what's the deal? Well, 24-hour urine tests show iodine levels to be 5 times lower than that 385 micrograms. And it's believed that this is likely due to the fact that iodine attached to salt has very low bioavailability, meaning it's really hard to be absorbed. And this was proven in a study back in 1969, where they took iodine in salt and iodine in bread, and they gave the iodized salt to one group, and they gave the iodized bread to another group, and if you bear with me, I do have the numbers of this study written down in a pile of papers here. All right, you know what? I'm just going to pause it, and I'll come back with those numbers. Okay, I'm back. So, turns out the details were that both groups were supplemented with 750 micrograms of iodine, one being the iodine was attached to salt, the other group having the iodine attached to bread, or cooked into bread. And they measured the blood serum afterwards, and they found that in the iodine bread group, they had a blood serum of 18.7 micrograms per liter of iodine. And the iodized salt group only had a blood serum level of 1.7 micrograms of iodine per liter, which is very, 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 very significant and demonstrates how difficult it is for iodine to be absorbed when it's attached to salt. All right, let's get going. So here are the RDAs set by the Institute of Medicine. So 150 milligrams a day for adults and 220 milligrams a day for pregnant women and 290 micrograms a day for breastfeeding women. And the RDA was established for goiter cretinism prevention, not for optimizing thyroid, endocrine, and immune function. The RDA is inadequate in preventing hypothyroidism, Graves' disease, Hashimoto's disease, thyroid cancer, and overall body system function. So the World Health Organization sets moderate to severe iodine deficiency on a urinary spot check at less than 50 micrograms per liter and a severe iodine deficiency at less than 20 micrograms per liter. And between 1970 to 2000, a moderate severe deficiency increased over 450% from 2.6 to 11.7% respectively. And this is in America. Now, women of childbearing age in 2005 were found to be at a 16.8 moderate to severe deficiency. And in 2008, which is the latest data, they were found to have a 14.6 modest to severe deficiency. And that's pretty significant when you think of all the birth defects that can be related to a lack of iodine. And, you know, thinking about autism spectrum alone is a real cause for concern. You know, not even thinking about mental retardation or cretinism. All right, so why dietary deficiency? Well, that is, diets tend to be lacking in ocean fish and sea vegetables. Diets tend to be lacking in we have low iodized salt diets. We have high carbohydrate diets. So here's another fun fact. Iodine used to be used as an anti-caking agent in bakery products up until the 1980s when they removed it for fear of causing hyperthyroidism. And then what did they do? They replaced it with bromine, which is from the same family on the periodic table of elements, the halogens, the same family as iodine. And what bromine has is zero therapeutic value for the body. It's a toxin, and it actually inhibits iodine because what it does is it'll be taken up by all the receptor sites in the body that iodine will attach to, and now it will plug those sites, and iodine competes for those sites and can't get in. So when you're thinking about why this lack of iodine today, it has to do not only with the fact that they took it out of the bread products or bakery products, which had a really high bioavailability, as we just discussed, and then they added a toxin that makes it harder for iodine to be absorbed. So it's really difficult to get iodine now. And And the next up, we have vegan vegetarian diets. So if they are not eating ocean fish or sea, well, of course they won't be eating fish, but if they're not eating sea vegetables, then there's going to be an issue there. And often they are eating more carbohydrate diets or bakery product diets, breads and pasta. And so their environmental toxicity is going up, preventing them from absorbing more iodine. So back to bromine here. So that's the halogen. That's the closest molecular weight to iodine, structurally similar. Was added to baked goods. It's in automobile interiors. So that new car smell, some of that smell is due to bromine, and it's never going to really quite go away. So when your car is parked out in the sun all day long, or even for short periods of time, and you get in there, you're breathing in bromine, and it'll absorb through your skin as well. So best to, you know, open the door, let the hot air out for a good 30 seconds to a minute or at least, and before you get in there, and then drive away. But, you know, drive away with the windows down for a little while. It's in our swimming pools because it's antibacterial, and it's an agricultural fumigant. It's in soda pop, prescription drugs, fire retardants. It's in furniture, carpet, computers, you name it. It competitively inhibits iodine, so it binds wherever iodine binds, as already mentioned. And conventional T4, T3, that's thyroid hormone, the conventional hormone testing can't decipher iodide versus bromide. So meaning that, okay, you could be tested to have good, adequate T4, T3 levels, but it's not going to tell you if it's iodine in there or bromine. So, and if bromine's in there, then it's not working properly. Okay, iodine deficiency. Iodine was originally added to baked goods, but removed for 10 years later for fear of hyperthyroid risk. We already talked about that. Therefore, there we go, lowered iodine intake, and we have greater competition for iodine to access receptors. Perchlorate is another member of the halide family. This is an industrial chemical. It's found in contaminated water, and it also competes for iodine receptors. And we'll talk a little bit more on iodine deficiency down the road here. Measuring iodine. So Dr. Brownstein recommends the loading test to be the best method. He recommends 50 milligrams, taking 50 milligrams of iodine and then collecting your urine for the next 24 hours. So I would suggest, you know, you wake up, have your first morning urination, and then you take the tablet, and then you collect your urine for the next 24 hours. And sufficient status, you'll excrete 90% of it, of that 50 milligrams, and in a deficient status, you will excrete less than a 90%. And the reason being is that if you are deficient, then your body is going to absorb it more. It's going to take as much as it can get, and therefore you won't excrete as much of it. And that's the premise. So Dr. Brownstein and associates have tested over 6,000 patients and found approximately 96% were iodine deficient, which is consistent with the results of other worldwide researchers. And that reminds me, this Dr. George Fletches, he had done some research with Dr. Brownstein's mentor, Dr. Guy Abraham, and I do have something here written by him. I'm going to pause this so I can find it in my mountain of papers. One sec. Okay, so I went and recorded about a good half hour or so before I realized that I didn't hit the record button. So I believe this is where I left off. Dr. Fletches says, hormone receptors and iodine. All hormone receptors are dependent on iodine, which increases the sensitivity of the receptor to the hormone it is designed for. For example, it can increase the sensitivity of insulin receptors and thus help with diabetes. Similarly, it can increase the sensitivity of the receptors for neurotransmitters, such as serotonin, dopamine, and GABA, in the brain. Thus, depression may lift after taking iodine. It can also increase the sensitivity of receptors for testosterone and FSH and LH, which is why some people are cured of diabetes by taking iodine supplements. also why iodine cures low libido and hypothyroidism. And low libido makes sense because that is usually attributed to low testosterone. Okay, so here is, we already went through the loading test, so let's move forward. Iodine and iodide. So Dr. Jean Lugol used iodide to treat infection back in the 1800s, and he found that potassium iodide increased the water solubility of iodine. Now, iodine is poorly water soluble, and iodide is simply the reduced form of iodine, meaning it contains one extra electron. And Lugol's iodine, which is 5% iodine and 10% potassium iodide and 85% distilled water, contains, or has in two drops of Lugol's iodine, contains, or 0.1 milliliters of iodine, it contains 5 milligrams of iodine, 7.5 milligrams of iodide. And Dr. Brownstein states this as being very close to the sufficient physiologic dose that we need. So different tissues use different forms. The thyroid, the skin, breast, prostate use iodine, whereas kidneys, spleen, liver, blood, salivary glands, intestines can use either form. Therefore, he just says it's best to use a combination of the two forms and let the body choose what it wants where and where it needs to put which. All right. So the average adult thyroid holds 15 to 20 milligrams of iodine, but can hold up to 50 milligrams when levels are sufficient. It uses the sodium iodine symporter, the abbreviated form, the NIS, to concentrate iodine, which is also found in breast, kidney, placenta, stomach, rectum, salivary glands. It's all over the body. And the pathway for iodine is that the hypothalamus, the pathway of thyroid hormone is, let me back up. I think I just missed a little bit of a point here, that it's not just the thyroid that uses the sodium iodide symporter, it's everywhere. So we'll get into that further. Now here, the thyroid pathway is that, I already feel like I talked about this because I talked about this for a half hour before I noticed that my screen wasn't recording. So it's going to require a little bit of work here to remember what I did, what I feel like I already thought I had said. All right. So thyroid hormone pathway is the hypothalamus, which is a gland in the brain, sends a messenger to the pituitary gland in the brain. And the messenger is TSH, which is thyroid stimulating releasing hormone. And that tells the pituitary to send another signal to the thyroid gland, and the signal is thyroid stimulating hormone, or TSH, and the thyroid gland then produces T4, which is the thyroid hormone, and that gets sent out into the periphery, and when it's needed to become active, it becomes T3. And T4 has four iodines attached to it, whereas T3 has three iodines attached to it. And I like to think of it as T4 is the car in neutral and T3 is the car in drive. And by drive, I mean drives body metabolism. It's active. And so the thyroid hormone is essential for normal brain development in newborns. And when it's deficient, we see mental retardation, goiter, a lower IQ, ADHD or autism spectrum, and we have autism there, and stillbirth. So keep that in mind because that's a good point to come back to later on. So, and this is all, low thyroid hormone can be linked to iodine deficiency. So blood tests may not be sensitive enough to detect thyroid abnormalities. Therefore, an iodine loading test is a better choice, according to Dr. Brownstein. So glands and iodine. Iodine is responsible for maintaining normal architecture of glands. So thyroid, ovaries, uterus, breast, prostate, which is why we see cancers, iodine-deficient cancers in these tissues, in these particular glands. Okay, iodine deficiency leads to cystic tissue. And cystic tissue is just, it's like a fluid-filled bubble in tissue. Oh, whenever I see or read or hear the word cyst, I always think back to first year med school and in the cadaver lab and seeing cysts there. And of course, they're no longer fluid-filled, but what they look like are craters. They look like meteors have struck the ground and left a whole bunch of craters. And it is not the ideal picture of optimal health. I will always remember what cystic kidneys look like. All right, so iodine deficiency leads to cystic tissue, and cystic tissue can become nodular or firm, and then from there it can become hyperplastic, which is an overgrowth of cells, and that unchecked cell growth, that is precancerous, so that can lead to cancer. So you can see the chain of events here. Iodine deficiency leading to cystic tissue, leading to nodular tissue, leading to hyperplasia, leading to cancer. Now, generally takes 3 to 6 months of iodine supplementation to improve or reverse cysts, nodules, or disrupted glandular tissue architecture, and may take years in several cases. So say you're diagnosed with an iodine deficiency and you have hypothyroidism and you're being medicated for it. You're taking thyroid hormone. So what are the options? Well, the options are you either stay on the same thyroid hormone dose, you reduce the dose in half, or you stop taking the thyroid hormone altogether. And the issue is it's hard what to know what the individual needs. And so Dr. Brownstein says generally one-third will need to reduce their thyroid hormone dose, two-thirds will remain at the same dosage, and some will just simply no longer require the medication at all. And so how do you find out? Well, you start the iodine, and if hyperthyroid symptoms occur, then you cut the thyroid hormone in half. And then if symptoms remain, then you stop the thyroid hormone completely. And what are hyperthyroid symptoms? Well, that's things like nervousness, anxiety, heart palpitations, sweating, feeling hot, increased bowel movements. But keep in mind that these signs are also can be a result of a detoxification reaction, because the iodine is displacing toxins that was competing with before. Well, it's still competing with, but like bromine that we had talked about. So now we're bringing more iodine in, and now bromine is being kicked off and it's also having a harder time to compete for receptors. And so that bromine can be causing these symptoms, these detox symptoms or hyperthyroid symptoms. So thyroid stimulating hormone is released from the anterior pituitary gland, and it stimulates the thyroid to make thyroid hormone. But it also stimulates the body to produce iodine transport molecules, known as the sodium iodide supporters, the NIS. So this is responsible for allowing iodine into cells. And when we have less iodine, then we have less of these supporters, these transporters available. Because the body's very conservative. If we go into a deficiency and say we have all these symporters hanging around, well, the body says, why do I have all these workers? I don't need all these workers. They're not working. They're not doing anything. I may as well scrap them and use their parts for something else, recycle them. So, and that's what it does. And then when we increase iodine, then the body says, well, okay, I have to fulfill this big supply coming in, and so now I need to make more workers, more NIS to deal with the increased supply. So that's what it does. So the signal to make more of these workers or make more of these transporters is TSH, and I'll just read the last point here. More iodine equals more NIS created to handle the increased volume of iodine. And then we have more iodine transported into the thyroid and more thyroid hormone produced. So there is maybe a myth would be a good way to put it. The Wolf-Chekhov effect, which is that an increase in iodine causes hypothyroidism. We'll address that right now in this slide. So, and hypothyroidism is tend to be seen with an increased TSH. So, you would also want to see, though, a falling of T4, T3. Anyway, Dr. Brownstein's experience is that an elevated TSH without falling T4 or T3, nor clinical signs of hypothyroidism, like hair loss, fatigue, or headaches, after iodine supplementation begins, should not be diagnosed as hypothyroidism. The increased TSH is due to increased demand for the NIS, which can take 6 months to normalize until the thyroid becomes saturated with iodine. And the normal ranges of TSH is 0.5 to 4.5 milli international units per liter. And he has witnessed 5 to 30 milli international units per liter for periods within 6 months of iodine treatment. So TSH levels initially rise when starting iodine therapy. It's not something to really freak out about, I guess, if I want to just put it in lay terms. And here he says again, increasing TSH levels without falling T3 and T4 levels and clinical signs and symptoms do not indicate iodine-induced hypothyroidism. So here's a list of hypothyroidism signs and symptoms. You can pause here if you want to read through them. I'm going to move forward. Okay, iodine-induced hyperthyroidism, this is extremely rare. And Dr. Brownstein and partners estimate less than 10 patients in the past 12, probably over 12 years of treating thousands of iodine-deficient patients. What you want to be concerned about, though, is there is a contraindication to iodine supplementation, and that is in the presence of a hot nodule. You want to make sure that that is surgically removed from the thyroid before you treat with iodine. Okay, so the iodine pathway. Iodine and iodide are ingested and absorbed in the gastrointestinal system, and they're transported into the thyroid cells via the NIS that we talked about, and it then undergoes oxidation and organification. So in the thyroid, iodide is converted to iodine. So iodide is the form that is taken into the thyroid cell, and then it gets and then through oxidation, it gets converted to iodine. And so this requires hydrogen peroxide, that's that H2O2 listed there, and an enzyme called thyroperoxidase, or TPO for short. And it also involves a cofactor, which is NADPH. And this is also activated by intracellular calcium and inhibited by the presence of delta-iodolactone, which I'll talk about very quickly here. This is the first step, and then the second step is the organification phase. So now we have the iodide has been converted to iodine, and now it is being attached to an organic molecule to become part of a cholesterol, which is hormone, a lipid, or a protein. Okay, so remember that the RDA is set at 150 micrograms per day of iodine, which is barely enough to make thyroid hormone and prevent goiter. It's not enough to prevent cancer. At 100 times the RDA, so around 15 milligrams a day, we produce iodolipids. That's that delta-iodolactone that I mentioned in the last slide. And at 12 to 50 milligrams, a day is sufficient for the vast majority of adults, but you can take up to 100 milligrams a day, according to Dr. Brownstein. Now, remember that the delta-iodolactone, I'll talk about it a little bit here, it feeds back into this oxidation phase and well, I'm going to talk about this in the next coming slides. So Take a time out and let's just talk about this 15 milligrams a day, because this can be very surprising or scary to some individuals, and because it's super high relative to the 150 micrograms. So, former research indicates the average daily Japanese diet or iodine intake to be 13.8 milligrams a day. And why do they choose Japanese? It's because they have, well, obviously they have the highest iodine consumption, but as a result, they have the lowest prevalence of thyroid-related disease and the iodine-linked cancers. So remember, we had just mentioned back here, I guess it was quite a while. Here we go. So remember, iodine is responsible for the maintenance of normal architecture of glands like the thyroid, ovaries, uterus, breast, and prostate. Well, the Japanese population is low in those cancers. So relative to the rest of the world. And so that is why we're looking at the Japanese diet. So former research indicates the average daily Japanese iodine intake to be 13.8 milligrams a day. However, this may be an error due to calculations based on wet seaweed rather than dry seaweed. So the water weight obscured results. I don't believe that they compensated for the water, and therefore they calculated there to be more iodine than there actually was. And the average intake is likely a range of 1 to 5 milligrams a day, but may range from 1 to 13.7 milligrams a day. So there's a couple studies here I found, and if I didn't say it before, I'll say it now. This slide is my own research. This doesn't have anything to do with Dr. Brownstein. So Zeva and Zeva, they found that the average Japanese diet consumed 1 to 3 milligrams a day of iodine, while this 1993 study, they found a very big range of 1.8 to 13.7, but they said the average was about 5.3. So I will say, you know, there's probably a range of 1 to 5 for the average intake. And down here, we're looking at 5 milligrams a day has created iodolipids to treat breast cancer. And I believe this other study, I might be wrong, but it also had 6 milligrams a day. I know I read 6 milligrams a day in a breast cancer study. So the point being made is that over here, we're reading that at 100 times the RDA or over 15 milligrams a day, we're producing iodolipids. Well, we're actually producing those iodolipids down at, you know, this 5 milligrams a day. And, you know, if they're using that to treat breast cancer, it's likely safe. And if the Japanese are consuming 1 to 5 milligrams a day, then it's likely safe. So, you know, these are large, this, you know, 5 milligrams a day and even 1 milligram a day is large relative to 150 micrograms. There's 1,000 micrograms in a milligram. So, you know, the RDA is quite low. All right. 5 milligrams a day of iodide may be a more accurate daily requirement than 12.5 milligrams a day. But I want to just say, like, you know, Dr. Brownstein and his mentor, Dr. Abraham, they have decades of clinical experience. And if these high iodine consumptions were harmful, well, then, you know, they'd either be out of practice or they'd change the error of their ways very quickly. So their experience really, you know, it really counts for something. And I don't want to discredit that whatsoever. You know, science always changes. They'll always come up with something and say, okay, well, this is how it is. And then, you know, years pass and they'll discover that they were inaccurate and they'll make the change. And who knows what it will be like, you know, a decade from now. You know, the RDA can be much higher than it is, and who knows what it's going to be like 100 years from now. So, you know, clinical experience really says a lot, and you can't disregard that. You know, a laboratory is just a lab. When you're working with people, you're really observing the true experience. Okay, so back to delta iodolactone. So this regulates cellular proliferation and apoptosis. So that's an anti-cancer action. Apoptosis is targeted or triggered cell death. We need it. It keeps cells in check so that we don't get that hyperplasia that I talked about before. Remember when I talked about the sequence of events, the cystic tissue leading to the nodule tissue to the hyperplastic tissue. So this is where delta iodolactone comes in and helps keep that down. So delta iodolactone is not detectable in an iodine deficiency because it's not there. And delta iodolactone regulates the oxidation of iodide that I had previously mentioned. So here is Dr. Brownstein's proposed mechanism for autoimmune thyroid illness. It's fairly straightforward. So oxidative phosphorylation creates ATP. If you remember back in high school or university learning about glycolysis, it's just the breakdown of sugar to make ATP. So hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, is a byproduct of oxidative phosphorylation. And H2O2 and TPO, that enzyme that I mentioned earlier, oxidizes iodide to iodine. Now, in an iodine deficiency, we don't have iodolactone to stop the oxidation phase. So there's too much hydrogen peroxide being produced. Too much hydrogen peroxide damages the TPO. And then when we have damage, what does the body do? The body says, send in the troops. So the body produces antibodies against TPO, which worsens the surrounding proteins such as thyroglobulin. And then when we have more damage there, the body says, send in the troops. So the response is it produces antibodies against thyroglobulin. And now we have antibodies against TPO and we have antibodies against thyroglobulin, and that's Hashimoto's disease. And you can also see, may or may not see that in Graves' disease, you'll see anti-TSH antibodies in Graves' disease. So there's an increased incidence in anti-thyroid antibodies in iodine-deficient individuals. And in the early stages of an autoimmune thyroid illness, the thyroid can fluctuate between being underactive and overactive. So hypothyroid symptoms and hyperthyroid symptoms. And thyroid hormone stimulates the mitochondria to produce ATP. But if there's low thyroid hormone, then we have low mitochondrial stimulation. And so we produce low ATP. And then we have fatigue and brain fog and muscle aches, pain, fatigue with exercise, fibromyalgia. In the late stages, it's just exacerbated. So we have excessive oxidative damage to the mitochondria and we have low ATP. So the treatment for autoimmune thyroid illness is Well, assess iodine levels, and if they are deficient, then you correct the deficiency. Essentially, you treat the cause, which is what all primary health care practitioners should be doing. You want to provide enough iodine to produce iodolipids, and you want to stimulate the NADPH system to produce adequate hydrogen peroxide. So this might be a little bit confusing here, because I just said we want to produce iodolipids, and what do iodolipids do? I think I went too far. Here we go. So we want to go back to this oxidation reaction here, and we want to feedback here so that we decrease this H2O2. We keep this in check, because as we talked about with that proposed mechanism for autoimmune thyroid, we have unchecked H2O2 because there's no delta iodolactone to keep it in check, and this goes out of control. This damages tissue, and then we get an antibody response. So let's go back now to right here. So we want to produce iodolipids, and here we want to stimulate this system, this NADPH. We want to make sure we have that cofactor, and we also want to make sure we have this enough of this cofactor too. And the NADPH system is part of the pentose phosphate pathway, which is an offshoot of glycolysis or oxidative phosphorylation, and it produces hydrogen peroxide as well. So this offshoot system is very specific for the oxidative phase of iodide. And what we're doing is we want to ensure that this system, that we're producing these cofactors to feed the system. So on one hand, we're producing the balancer, which is the iodolipid. And on the other hand, we also just want to ensure that we have our essential our essential building blocks, I guess, our cofactors, that our supply is also adequate. So we do this by increasing ATP production, and you can do that by providing ATP cofactors. What are some of the top ATP cofactors? Vitamins B2 and B3. So that's riboflavin and niacin. So that's that part of the treatment. And now you also want to correct mitochondrial dysfunction, address the oxidative stress and the tissue damage. And how do you do that? Vitamin C, magnesium, and unrefined salt. So a quick note on vitamin C, the warning is that it can cause diarrhea. So kind of the test to do to see or find how much vitamin C you can take is you start at 1 gram a day, and then you just increase your dose by 1 gram a day until you get a loose stool, and then you know you've gone one too far, and you reduce your dose back to what it would have been the day earlier, which was 1 gram less. So you also want to ensure that, or remember that magnesium can loosen stools. So magnesium bisglycinate is generally the most tolerated form of magnesium. All right, and remember, antibodies can go away. They're not a lifelong sentence. And I'm going to take a little break, and I'll be right back. Okay, so Hashimoto's and Graves' disease. Iodine supplementation can cause a flare of either disease, but it's rare. You want to ensure that iodine is given as part of a holistic treatment protocol. So that means providing nutrients that slows down the oxidative damage. It means taking vitamin C and unrefined salt, magnesium and selenium to help do this or minimize this flare. So best to take this 2 to 4 weeks before starting iodine treatment. Okay, minimizing oxidative stress. What you want to do is, well, first, autoimmune is oxidative stress. And what is that? That's free radical damage. And what is free radical damage? That's too much fire burning. And when you have a fire, what do you want to do? You want to put the fire out. And how do you do it? You put it out with pure water, unrefined salt, a healthy diet, and low stress. So let's talk about water. What is pure water? What do I mean by saying that? Well, I mean, it's certainly not tap water. It's water that's free of environmental toxicity. So that would be reverse osmosis, distilled. There are some filters out there. The Berkey filter is a good one. And I did meet a really smart guy who had his own filtration business who used bone char to remove fluoride from his water. I'll be looking into something like that in the future. I thought that was pretty awesome. Anyway, yeah, that's if you don't have the luxury of having your own well. So now, why? Or I guess I could say, these waters are also, so they're free of environmental toxicity. And I guess that's where I need to go. What is environmental toxicity? Well, that's things like chlorine and fluoride and pharmaceutical drugs. Not too many people are aware of the fact that there are our tap waters are full of pharmaceuticals simply because people take drugs and then they excrete them. They go back to the water supply, and our treatment facilities, they can't filter all of those molecules. So they go back to the water supply and we consume them again. So now, when it comes to reverse osmosis and distilled, you have to remember that those waters, they don't have any minerals. And if you don't add or remineralize them, then your body will remineralize that water. And you don't want to do that. It will take minerals from your tissues and your bones. And we need to be intaking minerals. We don't need to be exporting them. So what you can do is, I know there's a brand out there called Concentrace. You can use that to remineralize your distilled or your RO water. You can also do cold infusion teas with high mineral plants like stinging nettle. Also, plants grown in volcanic soil. I know that there's a tea from Hawaii called Hawaiian white tea that's grown in Hawaii and near the volcano, so it's just higher in minerals. And what you do is you put it in a tea ball and you just let it soak in a pitcher of water, and just let it, it's a, called a cold infusion, you just let it mineralize that way. So yeah, and I'd also mentioned the Berkey. I have known one of those myself. But hopefully down the road, if you can have the luxury of having your own well, I say all the power to you. Now, we want to ensure adequate unrefined salt diet. I can't remember now if I talked about it when I thought I was recording and I wasn't. So I'll just say again, I think I did. The anti-caking agents with salt, they can contain cyanide, aluminum, ammonium, and dextrose, which is sugar. Yeah, I talked about salt, so I remember that now. But some good brands out there for unrefined salts. Sea salts are, I know Dr. Brownstein likes the Celtic sea salt brand. I also recommend the West Point Naturals brand, and Open Nature is another brand. Okay, so I have a note here on healthy diet for helping to put the fire out. Now, these are my own notes here under healthy diet as to, in simplest form, define what a healthy diet is. And that would be a diet that's low in carbohydrates, a diet that is high in non-starch vegetables, And if there's one thing I learned in naturopathic school, it's that fruits and vegetables prevent and solve everything. And I have listed here low sugar fruit. Now, one of my mentors was Dr. Mattson. He was my naturopathic doctor in North Vancouver, and who inspired me to become a naturopathic doctor. And he always says that, look, Mother Nature designed, how do I word this? So our food is full of information, and Mother Nature designed it so. And say I'm eating tropical fruit, which is grown in a really hot and sunny climate, then essentially I'm eating food that's telling my body, giving it the information that I am in a tropical environment. So maybe I don't need to work so hard to make vitamin D. And that's misinformation if I'm not in a tropical environment, if I'm not getting enough sun, and if I'm in winter, for example. So eating for your season, I could also add to this list, but I don't want to add too many things. But it's food for thought, if you will. If I'm indoors all day and it's summer outside, well, then I'm still in winter. I'm not really getting any sun. So I'll stick to soups and stews, those winter foods. Now, a diet, back to a healthy diet here. I have moderate fats, so no trans fats. And I have olive and coconut oil. So I just want to also stress that I don't use oils to cook. That's a myth. I use water. I get by using water to cook my food. And if you are going to use oil, I recommend coconut oil because it's more stable. Olive oil does have a high flash point, but it's very delicate. It's a very sensitive oil. It oxidizes very quickly. It can oxidize from light. So make sure it's in a dark bottle. Also be aware that fats love to store toxins, and so they should be in glass, because if they're in plastic, well, then they're absorbing xenoestrogens, they're absorbing plastic toxins, and then we ultimately consume those. So we want to avoid that. Now, a note here on olive is that I recommend getting organic olive oil, which is sad, because the olive tree doesn't have any predators, so therefore it doesn't need pesticides. And those trees are old. They're ancient. Their roots grow very, 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 very deep. So I'm not concerned about soil contamination. What I am concerned about is the fact that, or whether I'm actually getting olive oil. The olive industry is very corrupt. There's a lot of top brands out there that the studies are out that they even show that they're not containing the oil that they say that they have, or even the quality that they say they have. So, you know, organized crime is involved with this. So I just say, or I tend to think that it takes a lot to get a USDA certification, and there are severe penalties for breaking it. And that's why I recommend getting an organic olive oil, because you know that you're actually getting olive oil. And the last note here that I have for a healthy diet is moderate to high protein. And the general rule is 0.8 grams of protein per kilogram of lean body weight. So also the other rule is, if you exercise, then just instead of 0.8, it's 1 gram per kilogram of lean body weight. And if you're using pounds, I go, 150 pounds, lean body weight, I'm working out, so I'll make sure that I get 75 grams of protein a day. All right. And the key note to an essential note to a healthy diet is no processed food or refined sugar. And I really, really, really stress the no processed food. That's really important. You know, all things in moderation. So for me, you know, I don't want to kill my social life, but look, like, yeah, the no processed food. And you know, if you're going to go eat restaurant food, it's then make sure it's whole food. So avoid processed foods and restaurant food. Okay, enough on that. Now, reduce stress. So exercise is just as effective, if not better, than an anti-anxiety drug. Also, keep in mind, good sleep. Sleep that occurs in total darkness. I like the saying that every hour of sleep before midnight counts as two. And meditation, if you can. And actually, breathe. Believe it or not, it sounds funny, but believe it or not, we live in an age and society of non-breathers. Take some deep breaths every day, as often as you can. The world needs to take a big deep breath for many reasons. All right. So Dr. Brownstein's books here are listed at the end. He's got a guide to healthy eating, and he's got another one on salt. So the autoimmune thyroid disease misconception. If you remember, the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey reported a 50% decline in iodine levels between 1970 and 2012. And medical doctors today are taught that iodine causes autoimmune thyroid disease. However, research does not support this notion, as iodine levels have fallen in the past 40 years, while autoimmune thyroid disorders have risen. So this is the opposite of the expected outcome. So this is a misconception that iodine causes autoimmune thyroid disease. The conventional approach to autoimmune thyroid disease has basically three options. You can take an anti-thyroid drug to block the production of thyroid hormone. You can take radioactive iodine to destroy the tissue of the thyroid gland and its surrounding iodine receptors. But you want to remember that iodine is in all the cells of the body, and we have these receptors all over the place. So if you're going to do this, then expect to get sick. Now, there are conflicting studies on post-radioactive iodine illness, but you know, everybody's different, and some people just have a stronger vital force than others. And you're playing with fire if you're going to choose this option. And the last option here is a thyroidectomy, which is the surgical removal of the thyroid gland. So selenium now. Selenium is an antioxidant required in at least 11 enzymes. It must be acquired through the diet. It is a component of glutathione peroxidase, which is used to neutralize hydrogen peroxide to water. Selenium is a component of iothyronine deiodinase, which is the enzyme that converts inactive thyroid hormone T4 to the active form T3. Therefore, when we have low selenium, we have low glutathione peroxidase, which then means we are unable to neutralize excess hydrogen peroxide. And that goes, you know, that's not just for the thyroid, that's body system. But here we have listed, we have damaged TPO and surrounding proteins. And so autoimmune thyroid illness now with selenium deficiency, not just the delta-iodolactone that we had talked earlier about. So also with low selenium, we have the low iodothyronine deiodinase enzyme. So therefore, we have low T3. So we can experience hypothyroid symptoms there. So if deficient, dosages of 100 to 200 micrograms a day are safe. The RDA is 55 milligrams a day. I personally have dosed 200 milligrams, or pardon me, 200 micrograms a day for about 3 months, and then I reduce my patient to 100 for another extended period of time. So selenosis, which is too much selenium, is rare, and the signs that you would see would be things like hair loss, fatigue, irritability, a garlic breath odor, and mild nerve damage, which would be things like fasciculations, which is like muscle twitches, and lower deep tendon reflexes. So food sources of selenium are nuts, especially Brazil nuts, ocean fish, beef, and turkey. Okay, breast cancer and fibrocystic breasts. Breasts are a main storage and utilization site for iodine. Iodine is concentrated and secreted by mammary glands. Iodine is necessary for development and architecture of breast tissue. There's 4 times higher iodine concentration in breast milk than the thyroid gland, which demonstrates how important iodine is for baby. Now, in an iodine deficiency, we have a causative factor for breast cancer and fibrocystic breast disease. And we also want to note that ovaries contain the second highest concentration of iodine in the body. And if you remember, the apoptotic effect of iodolipids on tumors. So essentially what we're just saying is that without iodine, women are at a increased risk of breast cancer and fibrocystic breast disease and ovarian cancer. And we'd already talked about the architecture, iodine maintaining architecture. So there's that element as well. Okay. Iodine and estrogens. So estrogens are a steroidal class of hormones in women and men. However, they're 10 times lower in men. And in women, ovaries produce most estrogen. Estrogen promotes growth and function of female sex organs. It ensures optimal brain function, breast development, skin lubrication, strong bones, and may prevent cardiovascular disease. In imbalances of estrogen, we'll find things like weight gain, mood swings, diabetes, and breast, ovary, and uterine cancers. There are 3 types of estrogen. There's estrone, E1, estradiol, E2, and estriol, E3. And iodine helps maintain a balanced estrogen ratio that favors the safest form, which is estriol, E3. It is impossible to balance these estrogens when iodine is deficient. In an iodine deficiency, ovarian estrogen production increases, and estrogen receptors in the breast increase. This increases the risk of breast pathology, including cancer. An increase in breast estrogen receptors then increases binding to environmental estrogens because we're more susceptible now. And environmental estrogens, also called xenoestrogens, they're found in plastics, pesticides, and meat and dairy products because those animals tend to be fed hormones. So what you want to do is you want to correct the iodine deficiency. And when you do that, expect a return of normal breast tissue. The BRCA1 gene. So this is often misleading. A lot of people, when they hear the word BRCA1, they think it's a license for breast cancer. No, it's not. BRCA1 is a tumor suppressor gene that modulates estrogen activity. It's a tumor suppressor gene. So when there's a mutation in the BRCA1 gene, that's an increased risk of breast cancer. There has to be the mutation. It's not simply having the presence of the gene, it's the mutation of the gene. And iodine and iodide increases the BRCA1 activity, which is a good thing. Why? Because it's a tumor suppressor gene. We want to suppress a tumor. And a final note here, iodine and iodide may enhance tamoxifen therapy by preventing and slowing down its resistance. And tamoxifen is a breast cancer drug, for those that don't know. Okay, fibrocystic breast disease. Breasts have cysts and are painful to touch. The cysts can be soft or firm and changed based on the menstrual cycle. And some physicians consider this benign, while others consider it to be a precursor for breast cancer. So estrogens are perceived as the causative factor, which includes breast cancer, and the oral contraceptive pill is often prescribed to suppress the ovaries and lower the estrogens. Now, this can be exacerbated by caffeine and trans fats, and alleviated and prevented by healthy fats, essential fatty acids, vitamins E and A, and minerals, and believe it or not, iodine. So, thyroid disease and cancer. Iodine deficiency is associated with thyroid swelling and goiter. And goiter is also associated with breast, stomach, esophagus, ovaries, and uterine cancer. There's controversy between hypothyroidism and breast cancer. But, you know, Dr. Brownstein, his clinical experience reports there is a relationship. I would agree. Makes sense. Hypothyroidism lowers the immune system, which in turn increases the cancer risk. 50% increased incidence of breast cancer with thyroid hormone treatment. Very interesting. And the lowest rates of breast, ovarian, and endometrial cancers in Japan compared to America. Which then interesting here that the Japanese population or a person from Japan, when they move to America, their increase of thyroid cancer or their increase of breast, ovarian, endometrial cancer increases, which is likely due to a lower iodine intake. Okay, thyroid hormone medication for iodine deficient hypothyroidism. So taking thyroid hormone increases metabolism. So we're burning more ATP by taking thyroid hormone. And this increased metabolism increases the demand for more iodine. However, less ATP is available for cellular uptake of iodine, because we're burning it. It's a bit of a catch-22. And now we're having difficulty concentrating iodine in its target cells because of the less ATP available. This results in further exacerbation of iodine deficiency, which increases the risk of breast cancer, as breasts and thyroid gland enlarge to compensate for iodine deficiency. They become hyperplastic and we have a precancerous lesion. Okay. Breast cancer precursors. Iodine deficiency, obviously. Xenoestrogens, so those are plastics, so BPA, phthalates, which is added to plastics to make it more flexible. Hormone-fed animals, we've talked about this. Living in the American goiter belt, that's soils with very low in iodine, and they have the highest breast cancer mortality rate. The approximate breast iodine demand is 5 milligrams a day in a 110-pound or 50-kilogram female, And the hypothesis is that breast tissue requires a higher iodine demand, and therefore women require more iodine than men. In cancer, iodide has been shown to be ineffective in reversing precancerous breast tissue in animals, whereas iodine has been effective. Iodine decreases lipid peroxidation, and lipid peroxidation is free radical damage to cell membrane lipids and the mitochondria, which leads to serious illnesses like cancer and autoimmune disorders. The general treatment for iodine deficiency breast cancer is, number one, balance the iodine, and then balance the hormonal system, correct the nutritional deficiencies, balance the diet, and make sure that that's free of synthetic hormones. And if for more information, Dr. Brownstein's got a book out there called The Miracle of Natural Hormones. Okay, so iodine is used everywhere. The thyroid gland gets the first pick for iodine, and therefore other tissues can have a real severe deficiency if we aren't getting enough iodine. So essentially, the thyroid gland gets first pick and everybody else gets the table scraps. And how long can you live on table scraps without some sort of pathology arising? Now, iodine is used by the breasts, the ovaries, which take the second highest concentration. So I kind of look at it this way, as the thyroid takes the first pick and then it throws its scraps to the ovaries. And then if there's anything left, then the ovaries tosses out to the rest of the body. Now, the other tissues are the prostate, the gastrointestinal tract, the salivary glands, bones, connective tissue, almost entire body fluids. Animal studies on iodine deficiency found problems in the adrenal glands, the thymus gland, the ovaries, the hypothalamus, the pituitary axis, the entire endocrine axis. And the point is that it's impossible to have an optimally functional hormonal system when iodine is deficient. When iodine is sufficient, the thyroid gland contains about 50 milligrams of iodine. The total body contains around 1,500 to 2,000 milligrams of iodine, and the highest amounts are found in the striated muscle and the fat tissue. Obesity increases the iodine demand, as fat cells require more iodine, so keep that in mind if you're treating an obese individual, they're going to require more iodine. Dr. Guy Abraham, who was Dr. Brownstein's mentor, suggested a daily iodine intake of 13 milligrams a day in the absence of deficiency. And when iodine is sufficient, the thyroid gland requires around 6 milligrams a day, while the breasts require around 5 milligrams a day. Okay, pregnancy. So I mentioned cretinism before. It's a disorder in offspring of severely iodine deficient mothers. It's severe mental retardation. There's, of course, low IQ, swelling of skin, hair loss, short stature, reduced muscle tone and reflexes. It's still present in remote areas of the world, and it was eliminated with iodized salt in the first world. So the National Health and Nutritional Examination Survey found iodine deficiency in nearly 60% of women of childbearing age in the U.S. And that was between 2005 to 2008. That's pretty significant. If you're anticipating getting pregnant, you really want to address this. I mean, 60%. That's astounding. And we don't hear about it. Consequences of iodine deficiency in pregnancy are an increased neonatal fatality, a lower IQ in offspring, a delayed development quotient, which is basically an IQ test before you can actually measure IQ, and a a delayed neurobehavioral performance in children at 18 months. We're looking at ADHD. You may as well just say autism spectrum disorder. We're looking at depression, dwarfism, cretinism, mental retardation, autism should be listed there. So 60% of women of childbearing age in the U.S. are iodine deficient. And that was in 2008. That's our latest data. I'm sure it probably hasn't changed much. This should scare you if you are considering getting pregnant. And if you have offspring, children, who have any of these things that are just listed now, you should be angry. This should be common knowledge, and it's not. And I'm angry, and that's why I'm doing this lecture. All right, time to do something about it. So iodine is most important in the first trimester when the brain and neurological systems are first formed. And Japanese women ingest approximately 12 milligrams a day of iodine without reports of adverse effects and have much lower infant mortality rates than the U.S. And that, keep in mind, this comes from Dr. Brownstein's book. And I already talked about earlier that that 12 milligrams may be incorrect. It might be 5, I don't know. But I trust his clinical experience. So children. Children require iodine for normal function and maintenance of endocrine and brain development. A meta-analysis of 18 studies on iodine deficiency found 13.5-point lower IQ in children and adolescents. Iodine deficiency is correlated with low growth hormone, which resolves once deficiency is correlated. Low growth hormone just means not growing, or not growing as they normally should be growing. The World Health Organization recommends a daily iodine intake for children to be 90 micrograms a day for 0 to 59 months, 120 micrograms a day for the ages 6 to 12, and 150 micrograms a day for over the age of 12. And they only recommend 200 micrograms a day in pregnancy and breastfeeding, which is lower than the Institute of Medicine, which suggested 290 for pregnancy and 220 for breastfeeding. And Dr. Brownstein states these levels are inadequate, and I would have to agree. Okay, so recall the iodine loading test that we talked about earlier. So just in children, you need to lower the dosage. So if a child weighs less than 80 pounds, then 12.5 milligrams of iodide should suffice, not the 50 milligrams. And then everything else is the same. Just remember, and when you dose anything, no one dose fits all. He's got a general formula of 0.25 milligrams per kilogram a day, or 0.11 milligrams per pound a day. Okay, toxic halides. So this is group 7A of the periodic table, the second last right-hand column on the side, containing bromine, chlorine, fluorine, iodine, and astatine. And these are all toxins that can replace iodine. Let's start with bromine. We've talked a little bit about it already, but there is no known therapeutic value to bromine, and its toxicity is very common. Bromine absorbs in the intestinal tract. It's very similar in size and shape to iodine and allows for easy binding to iodine receptors. It's toxic. It's toxic to the thyroid gland, and it disrupts functioning. The term for that is a goitrogen. You may have also heard the word goitrogen before when it applied to foods. Those foods are usually of the brassica family, so things like broccoli and cauliflower and cabbage. I don't really care about those foods. Those foods are awesome liver foods, and I don't think our diets get enough of them, so I'm not really concerned about them being goitrogens. I'm more concerned about environmental toxins being goitrogens. So, where we left off, we left off with thyroid hormone becomes brominated rather than iodinated, and therefore we have thyroid dysfunction. And we have autoimmune and hypothyroidism. There's a small study that reports twice the levels in women with breast cancer than women without. Bromine can only be eliminated if iodine is sufficient, and 50 milligrams of iodide ingested will produce a 50% increase in bromine excretion, which is awesome. Okay, bromanism is the intoxication of bromine, and its symptoms are delirium, psychomotor retardation, schizophrenia, hallucinations, inability to concentrate, having a dull affect, being depressed, headaches, and irritability, and its symptoms can occur at low levels. Bromine is an antibacterial agent in swimming pools and hot tubs, and it's a fumigant for agriculture, termites, and other pests. It's a flame retardant component. It's in computers and furniture and clothing and bedding. It's been reported to be found in soft drinks and energy drinks and sports drinks. It's an anti-caking agent used in bakery products. If you recall, it was switched from, we talked about it when it was switched, when iodine was switched to bromine back in the 1980s, which is why we've seen a further exacerbation of iodine deficiency in the last 40 years. Bromine is formerly found in over-the-counter drugs. It's currently found in prescription drugs, typically inhalers and bladder drugs. And Dr. Brownstein has tested bromine levels in over 1,000 patients and found 100% of them to be high. So remember that bromine binds to all iodine receptor sites, not just the ones in the thyroid gland. Fluoride. So fluoride was added to drinking water to prevent dental caries, though studies report its inefficacy. It may have some topical benefit for teeth between the ages of 3 to 13. I'm not going to get into the whole dental carie argument. I'll just say read The Devil's Poison by Dean Murphy for more information. Dr. Brownstein also recommends. So fluoride inhibits iodine concentration in the thyroid gland, thereby increasing the risk of goiter. In the US, the average water fluoride levels is 1 part per million, which is scary considering that this is a lot higher than the 0.23 part per million that was found to cause goiter back in 1972. And look at how our iodine levels have decreased since then, when you consider that they've fallen by 50% between 1970 and 2012. So we're less protected against fluoride. Fluoride is contained in many prescription drugs, like antacids, anti-anxiety, antidepressant, antifungal antibiotics. It's in NSAIDs and it's in steroids. And reports of SSRIs, there are reports of SSRIs increasing breast cancer, so maybe there's an iodine link here. Fluoride now being the cause and leading to further exacerbation of an iodine deficiency. Chlorine. So chloride is an important element in our extracellular fluid. We can't live without it. Chlorine, though, is toxic. It's a disinfectant, and it's in our water, our swimming pools, it's in our hot tubs. Now, look, we need to ensure that we have clean drinking water. So chlorine had its purpose. But even Dr. Brownstein says we have other ways that could be more efficient. We could be using iodine to disinfect our water. We could be using ultraviolet light. We could be using hydrogen peroxide. We're a clever species. We can use substances that are not so toxic. Chlorine is a whitener. It's also found in artificial sweeteners. It causes birth defects. It causes stillbirth. And it causes cancer. Chlorine is a byproduct of digoxin, which is arguably the most extreme carcinogen on the planet. Perchlorate is one atom of chlorine surrounded by four atoms of oxygen. It's man-made and it's found naturally. It displaces iodine and damages the sodium iodide symporter, the NIS. It was discontinued in the 1960s as a means for hyperthyroid treatment, if you can believe that. So low levels are found to cause thyroid cancer and hypothyroidism and mental irregularities and immunosuppression. It's found in airbags. If you're wearing any leather, then you're wearing perchlorate because it's used in leather tanning. It's in fireworks and it's in rocket fuel. And it's most often found in contaminated groundwater because manufacturers dispose it into places like abandoned mines. So, on the note of contaminated water, if you're eating crops that have been irrigated with contaminated water, such as crops from the lower Colorado River, who tend to irrigate more in the winter months of the southwestern U.S., then you're probably consuming perchlorate. And it doesn't matter if your product is organic or conventional. So head lettuce is one of the top crops that is very high in perchlorate. So if you can find out where your food is being produced, I would recommend that. All right, so perchlorate crosses the placenta and causes in utero thyroid abnormalities. And if you remember, the World Health Organization states thyroid abnormalities are the leading cause in preventable mental retardation. There is an inverse correlation with iodide in breast milk. And keep in mind that breast milk is the only source for iodide for infants. Perchlorate has also been found to cause irreversible brain function decline in rats. Go figure. If this doesn't make you angry, I don't know what will. Okay, so things that perchlorate can cause: breast disease, hypothyroidism, immune system problems, newborn mental retardation, neurological problems, poor fetal development, poor neonatal development, and thyroid cancer. So how to detox from all this crap? Dr. Brownstein's four steps to detox toxic halides. This is essentially the same thing that we're prescribing for everything related to iodine deficiency. So again, hydration, so pure water, which we talked about, unrefined salt, which we talked about. Remember that chloride competitively inhibits bromide, which is a good thing. Alkalizes, balances the mineral content, and electrolytes facilitate iodine uptake. Antioxidants, so that's our vitamin C, selenium, which then helps, magnesium, which then helps create glutathione, another antioxidant like selenium. And we want to use iodine. Now, keep in mind that you may experience detoxification reactions. So that's things like headache, fatigue, muscle aches, heart palpitations, fever, diarrhea, brain fog. And you can avoid this by doing steps 1 through 3 here. So hydration, salt, and antioxidants for 2 weeks before starting an iodine treatment. Iodine dosage guidelines: mainland Japanese iodine intake, approximately 13.8 milligrams a day. Main source is seaweed. Have the lowest breast, ovarian, endometrial, and prostate cancer rates and fibrocystic breast disease compared to America. So, and that approximate 13.8 might be off. It might be 1 to 5 milligrams a day. But the case in point is that they still have the highest iodine intake and the lowest rates above said rates. Okay, so the last slides here in this section just deal with the concerns of taking iodine above the RDA, which we've already addressed for the most part. So we'll go through them quickly. So, well, here's one. Iodine allergy. We haven't really addressed this, but this is rare. Dr. Brownstein reports seeing 3 patients in over 20 years of practice having an iodine allergy. And keep in mind that an allergy to radioactive iodine, so if you've been treated with radioactive iodine and you had a reaction, that doesn't guarantee that you're going to have a reaction to inorganic iodine, non-radioactive iodine. And a little fun fact down here at the bottom, you can cure allergies. Here are some techniques. Dr. Brownstein recommends NAET. I don't have experience with that, but I do have experience with being treated with JMT, NMT, and Body Talk, and I can recommend all of them. Autoimmune thyroid disease. So high iodine doses was the treatment of choice before radioactive iodine became available. Many studies support iodine as treatment. The cause of ATD points to iodine deficiency rather than excess. And remember that iodine levels have fallen over 50% in the past 40 years. Therefore, ATD should have fallen too if iodine excess was the cause. However, ATD has risen. So it's obviously not the cause. Dr. Brownstein's 20-plus year clinical experience of treating ATD with high-dose iodine and holistic treatment plan demonstrates demonstrates safety, and he states iodine deficiency to be the cause of ATD. Detox reactions. Iodine competes with toxic halides, and the release of toxic halides can cause detoxification reactions. This occurs around 5% of the time. It's minimized with the holistic treatment protocol that we've already gone through. Iodine-induced hypothyroidism. So when iodine-deficient animals and humans are given large doses of iodine, there is a transient period of decreased thyroid hormone production until the thyroid gland reestablishes itself. So we're looking at around 26 to 40 hours. And then the thyroid gland returns thyroid hormone levels to normal. There is a myth based, this iodine-induced hypothyroidism is a myth based from a 1960 goiter problem in Hokkaido, Japan. Western physicians erroneously claimed the cause was iodine. However, other sources were not investigated, like bromine. And furthermore, the same iodine consumption levels were found in other residents of Japan who did not experience hypothyroidism or goiter. So why they were drawn to this conclusion is beyond me. TSH will rise in about 25% of patients starting iodine supplementation, and that's a normal response. Remember that the TSH rises, or remember that the normal TSH is around 0.4 to 4.5 milli international units per liter, but you can expect to see a rise to 5 to 15 micro international units per liter for up to 6 months when treating with iodine. The increased TSH does not indicate iodine-induced hypothyroidism. T4 and T3 and reverse T3 will measure normal or improve, and patients will not experience hypothyroid symptoms. Therefore, this is not iodine-induced hypothyroidism. The iodine deficiency means also an NIS deficiency. We have low sodium iodide symporters because there's less iodine available. And TSH stimulates the NIS formation. This takes 3 to 6 months to saturate cells with iodine, and then the TSH will decline to the normal reference range in this time. The NIS, or the thyroid becomes saturated with NIS amongst other tissues, and the TSH returns to normal. All right. iodine-induced hyperthyroidism. Okay. This is not a common occurrence. In iodine deficiency, iodine supplementation can create hyperthyroidism symptoms like heart palpitations and nervousness. However, studies show these symptoms gradually decrease. And what you want to do is you want to monitor with routine lab checks and adjust the dosage accordingly. And remember that adequate, unrefined sea salt minimizes iodine side effects. Iodism. So this iodine dose is too high. It causes a metallic taste in the mouth, increased salivation, sneezing, headache, acne, sinus headache, and fever. You can take chlorophyll tablets to resolve the metallic taste. It's minimized by unrefined sea salt and vitamin C. And iodine excess is easily excreted by properly functioning kidneys. Thyroid cancer. 1% of cancers in America, a 3-to-1 ratio of women to men. Some reports of increased incidence with iodine supplementation. Iodine, but keep in mind that iodine deficiency has been increasing over the past 40 years, while thyroid cancer has been increasing, which is the opposite outcome expected if iodine is the cause. Iodine improves prognosis of thyroid cancer. Radiation has demonstrated to be the greatest cause. And in Chernobyl, potassium iodide was the treatment. Okay, 24-hour urine test and dosage. We've been through this. Testing saliva and serum iodide levels. So, this will help determine the mechanism efficacy through serum saliva testing. So this is basically just testing to see how environmentally contaminated the receptors are. So in a properly functioning person, your saliva will have a 42 time higher iodine level than the serum. So you test the serum and the saliva, and if you find that the saliva is lower than 42 times the serum, then you can diagnose a transporter dysfunction, meaning there's a goitrogen toxicity. That's, you're looking at the halide family, perchlorate, theocyanate, which is in cigarette smoke. What you can do is you can clear this up with vitamin C and unrefined sea salt. So iodine, in summary, every cell in the body requires iodine to function properly. White blood cells require iodine to fight infection. Glandular tissues, and that's something I didn't really mention with cancer, you know, immune cells fight cancer, but they can't do their job when they don't have the tools that they need, like iodine. Okay, glandular tissue require iodine to maintain proper architecture, and require iodine to produce hormones. Deficiency increases cancer risk of particularly the breast, ovary, uterus, prostate, and thyroid glands. And deficiency increases disease risk, particularly autoimmune thyroid disease, hypothyroidism, poor immune system, fatigue, ADHD, autism, and heart disease. So at the end of the day, treat the cause, don't treat the symptom. That's not rocket science. That's essential medicine in my mind, and that's why I chose to become a naturopath. It's because that is what we intend to do, is treat the cause. And as Dr. Brownstein would state, you know, we live in an age of nutrient deficiency. We don't have a drug deficiency. We have a nutrient deficiency. So give nutrients. Drugs have their place. Don't get me wrong. I think they're probably their greatest uses in emergency medicine. But for the most part, I don't think they treat the cause. Dr. Guy Abraham was Dr. Brownstein's mentor. He wrote a series of articles. You can find it at optimox.com. And I just want to say thank you to Dr. Brownstein and his mentor, Dr. Abraham, who's now passed away. But I'm really grateful for your work, and keep it up. So we're moving on to section two now. So this is the short component and maybe my favorite component of the lecture. So histamine. Histamine is a protein. It's in every tissue of the body. It's synthesized by mast cells, basophils, platelets, some neurons, and enterochromaffin cells, mainly the mast cells and the basophils. It's stored as granules intracellularly in vesicles and released on stimulation. It assists in healing and alerts us to environmental dangers by triggering pro-inflammatory mediators. So it's in, you know, when we have a traumatic incident, like physically traumatic incident, or if we have an allergic reaction, histamine is always involved. You know, sneezing, itching, runny nose, that's histamine. So here are a list of typical histamine release symptoms. You can pause now if you want to read them. I am going to move forward. So histamine release. Mast cells typically degranulate via the cross-linking of IgE antibody following the binding of an antigen. An antigen is your foreign material that's triggering the allergic response. So independent of this, histamine release is regulated by a secondary messenger signal, which is cyclic AMP and cyclic GMP. And so this is triggered by non-allergic stimuli. So think chemical or physical, could be medications, food. In a histamine intolerance, this is when histamine fails to break down. So now, you know, one of the reasons why it's going to fail to break down is not having enough of the enzyme that breaks it down, like diaminooxidase, or DAO, or DAO for short. So histamine is metabolized or broken down by two pathways. So one is the DAO. This is extracellularly. And this converts histamine into imidazole acetaldehyde, which is inert. And the thing is that the DAO can get tied up, breaking down histamine that we ingest. And therefore, it neglects the histamine that's released in the body. There's just simply not enough of it. So things that we ingest that can tie up the diaminooxidase are histamine-rich foods, alcohol, medications that block the DAO, or histamine-releasing medications. Another metabolic pathway for breaking down histamine is the ring methylation by histamine N-methyl transferase, which happens intracellularly. So here's a list of histamine-containing foods. And again, the DAO gets tied up breaking down histamine in food, which leaves less to break down the body's excess histamine, resulting in an exacerbation of histamine excess symptoms. So diaminooxidase. So abnormalities or polymorphisms associated with the DAO are found in inflammatory and neoplastic diseases like food allergies, celiac sprue, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, and colonic tumors. There are four types of receptors that mediate histamine in different tissues. There's more, but particularly the ones that we focus on are H1, H2, H3, and H4. And we'll go through them right now. So with H1, H1 receptors are found in the skin, the cardiovascular system, the gastrointestinal system, the uterus, and the respiratory tract. And so when histamine binds to these places, say if histamine binds to H1 receptors in the skin, then we're going to see an increase in endothelial permeability, and we're going to see itching, flushing, and urticaria, hives. If it binds to the cardiovascular system, we're going to see things like arrhythmia, anaphylaxis, low blood pressure or high blood pressure, or vertigo. If it binds to the gastrointestinal system, Then we're going to see smooth muscle constriction. So we're going to see stomach aches and pains, cramps, gas, bloating, and diarrhea. If it binds to the uterus, we see smooth muscle contraction there. So we have dysmenorrhea, which is painful menstrual periods. If it binds to the respiratory tract, which we also have smooth muscle contraction there, we have bronchoconstriction, which is chest pain. We have also see a mucus secretion and endothelial permeability. So we have the nasal congestion, the runny nose, the sneezing, shortness of breath, wheezing. When histamine binds to the number two receptors, we still have those cardiovascular, gastrointestinal, and skin symptoms, as in H1. But now we have also a chance of it attaching to the bone marrow. And I'll talk about that when we get to H4. When it binds to H3 receptors, this is our central nervous system. So we're going to experience a neurotransmitter release. So we're going to experience vertigo or headache or nausea or vomiting or insomnia, panic attacks, depression. We can experience irregularities in body temperature, appetite, locomotion, learning, and memory. And when it attaches to H4 in the bone marrow, which will regulate hematopoiesis, this is where we'll see, it's kind of the patient that we see who has low red blood cells or white blood cells, and they've got all the paperwork and all the labs, all the investigations, and they just can't, they've ruled everything out. Their doctors have ruled everything out, and they can't figure out why. Think histamine. So the point is that histamine can attach everywhere. One day, it can attach to H1. The next day, it can attach to H2 or H3 or H4. Or maybe it can attach to H4 and H1 on one day, or H2 and H3 on the next day. You can have it, meaning that you can have a headache one day, abdominal pain the next, or maybe both, or bloating the next day. Therefore, all of the symptoms listed in these previous slides are fair game. So all of these. And now, this is the money slide that I like to call it, that ties everything together, is that iodine inhibits the conversion of histidine to histamine, thus playing a role in controlling the production of histamine. That's a huge deal. this was actually hard to find. This I've seen like innumerable times in clinical experience, but is very unknown. And it was a hard find. It was difficult. It was a challenge to find the study. Studies from 1967. A lot of these studies just kind of got lost, I think. So yeah, I guess to just sort of in short talk about, you know, what my mentor, Dr. Schaefer, has put it is just that, you know, he went to school in the 1970s, and back then iodine and histamine, those were hot ticket research items on the table back then. And unfortunately, research and medicine is now for the longest time really dictated by the pharmaceutical industry. And so you can't patent iodine, so they don't really care about it. And this information just kind of got lost. And even in my one-ton Gabby nutrition textbook, it doesn't mention this or what I'm going to talk to you about when it comes to copper down the road here. So, you know, I guess the point is the information's coming out now. So if you remember, all of these symptoms, signs and symptoms from an iodine deficiency that we had just gone through in section one, we can now add to that all of these. And that's just huge. And what did we say earlier? It was found that 60% of women in America are iodine deficient. Crazy. Okay. And there was a last, I had a little note here. There is some research on iodine. It's not completely under the rug or just cut off. 2001, there was a study demonstrating that iodine inhibits histamine release in rats. And I should have mentioned that if you don't know what histidine is an amino acid that converts to histamine. So iodine is the feedback mechanism that when it's sufficient, it keeps histamine in check. All right. And we're going to close pretty soon here. So copper, I wanted to talk about copper because it's required to convert T3 to T4. And in the model below here, we have this organic chem model where we have a molecule of T4. We've got another one of T4 here. And we have copper being the linker between them. This is before it gets cut to T3. So copper is required for making thyroid hormone. And copper is also required for TPO expression. Remember that thyroperoxidase. So low copper, expect to see hypothyroid symptoms. But also, copper is required to break down histamine. It's a cofactor for diaminooxidase, the DAO. So I hope you remember now that the DAO is a cofactor for histamine, or the DAO is the enzyme that breaks down histamine. So if you don't have enough copper, then the DAO can't work and we can't break down histamine. So then we have all those histamine excess symptoms that we've gone through. And also additional cofactors here are vitamin B6 and vitamin C. So low copper leads to DAO inhibition, leads to histamine excess. So I just want to throw that in there because you could be misled. If you think you're seeing an iodine deficiency, it could be a copper deficiency. If you're seeing all those histamine symptoms and iodine deficiency symptoms, then make sure you want to investigate copper. So, and keep in mind that zinc and copper have an inverse relationship. So if you're consuming a lot of zinc, then expect copper levels to be low, and vice versa. If you're consuming copper levels to be If you're consuming a lot of copper, then expect zinc levels to be low. So as with everything, balance is the key. And that's it. You know, iodine and copper deficiencies lead to an excess of histamine. So thank you to Dr. Gary Schaefer for your mentorship and expertise on iodine, histamine, and copper. I really, really appreciate you. And thank you for listening. Please check out thenaturedoctor.ca. A little quick note on that is quite a number of years ago, I was in a master's program in Oxford in a program called Social Sculpture, which was essentially an art activist program to try and teach artists how to sculpt a better society by building more public awareness. And I actually didn't complete the program. I left. I took what I needed, and it just felt like it was time for me to leave. And lo and behold, I'm using it now. And I'm using it now as thenaturedoctor.ca. And the whole idea is to just inform and empower. And I hope you found this lecture useful and helpful. And there's going to be this lecture in summary, in about a five-minute summary, because, you know, this is probably a two-hour lecture at this point. So thanks for listening. Share the site. Check out the lots of free videos and health tips and information there. And And yeah, stay well. And peace.